A long time ago, when I was young and without rec, I made an egregious claim.
You are dead meat!
And just say that it's because mathematicians have no idea how to program and program.
I want to apologize.
I was a new channel, and I was going through many trying times, simultaneously. I was angry and confused. I've always been one to play it on the safe side, never really going far enough. But now I've done it and gone too far. This is a continuous journey for me, and by the intermediate value theorem, there was a point between A and B where I had just crossed the line. Let's find where that was. Finding zeros is pretty much equivalent to solving equations, which is a very commonplace challenge. Most people believe that solving equations is all a mathematician ever does. This widespread belief is completely wrong. Mathematicians don't care about solving equations. Suppose a mathematician is faced with an equation of the form f of x equals 0 that they need to solve for x, where f is a continuous function. If, for instance, f of 1 equals 2 and f of 5 is negative 4, then the mathematician says, we're done, a solution exists. Intuitively, f being continuous means that you can trace the plot of f on an xy plane without ever lifting your pencil. Therefore, if f of 1 is 2 and f of 5 is negative 4, any continuous trace connecting these two must pass through the x-axis at some point c, meaning that f of c is 0. This is the idea behind the intermediate value theorem. However, the intermediate value theorem says nothing more about where the solution c is. Or does it? There are several ways to prove the intermediate value theorem. Perhaps these proofs give insight for how to find a solution. To this end, I will provide two proofs. Here is an elementary proof. Suppose we have some inputs a0 and b0, where f of a0 is negative and f of b0 is positive. Without loss of any generality, we may assume that a0 is less than b0. Let's take m0 to be the midpoint between a0 and b0. Then there are three possibilities. If f of m0 is 0, then we're done. Take c to be m0 and that's the solution. If f of m0 is negative, then m0 serves as a lower bound for the solution c. So define a1 to be m0 and b1 to be b0. If, on the other hand, f of m0 is positive, then m0 serves as an upper bound for the solution c. So define a1 to be a0 and b1 to be m0. In either case, f of a1 is negative and f of b1 is positive, but the distance b1 minus a1 is half of the original. Now, take m1 to be the midpoint between a1 and b1. Then, again, there are three possibilities. If f of m1 is 0, then we have found our solution c. If f of m1 is negative, then define a2 to be m1 and b2 to be b1. If f of m1 is positive, then define a2 to be a1 and b2 to be m1. Again, this ensures that f of a2 is negative and f of b2 is positive, only this time the distance between b2 and a2 is a quarter of the original. If this process repeats indefinitely without ever finding a solution, then we get an increasing sequence an of lower bounds, where f of an is negative, and a decreasing sequence bn of upper bounds where f of bn is positive. The distance between bn and an is always 1 over 2 to the n of the original. The increasing sequence of ans is bounded above by b0, and therefore has a limit a infinity given by the supremum. Analogously, the decreasing sequence of bns is bounded below by a0. Therefore, this sequence admits a limit b infinity given by the infimum. Since the distance between bn and an decreases by a factor of 2 every step, this means that the limit points b infinity and a infinity have a distance of 0. In other words, a infinity and b infinity are equal to the same value c. Since f of an is always negative, the continuity of f ensures that f at the limit point c must be less than or equal to 0. Similarly, since f of bn is always positive, f at the limit point c must also be greater than or equal to 0. Since f of c must be both greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 0, it must be equal to 0. This proves the intermediate value theorem. Following this proof gives us an explicit algorithm for finding c. This method is called the bisection method, but it's pretty much the same as the binary search method that is familiar to most programmers. But gee, this algorithm runs forever, I hear you whine. Well, yes, but the proof also tells us that each step of the algorithm cuts the size of the interval where the solution could be by 50%. Therefore, we can use a finite version of the algorithm to approximate a solution to whatever precision we like. The leading intuition behind the intermediate value theorem is that continuous functions can't jump, unlike Crash Bandicoot. However, The elementary proof above obfuscates the importance of this property for the intermediate value theorem. Introducing a jump is the easiest way to construct non-continuous functions where the IVT fails. Here is a more elegant proof, which appeals to mathematical abstraction to isolate the key steps of the intermediate value theorem. This proof relies on concepts from topology, but we don't need the full theory here. That being said, before we can get into the proof, I need to break continuity for a moment and set up some background. So how is continuity defined? Well, in English, a function is continuous if whenever x and x0 are really close, then f of x and f of x0 are also really close. Put differently, allowing some wiggle room in the output translates to a little bit of wiggle room in the input. If the function is not continuous, then even a small amount of wiggle room in the input will cause a large jump in the output. One way to make wiggle room precise in math is by using the concept of an open set. In the context of the real number line, the open sets are given by unions of open intervals. Since open intervals don't have endpoints, you can always wiggle a point in the interval and remain inside, no matter how close to the edge you go. Now we can make continuity precise. A function f from R to R is continuous if the preimage of any open set under f is another open set. Hang on, this looks nothing like the continuity I learned, I hear you whine. There are no limits in this definition. I don't appreciate heckling, unless it's in the comments where I have enough time to conjure up a proper insult to respond with. But since you asked, here's a proof of the equivalence. Are you happy now? As we just saw, continuity has been rephrased in terms of open sets instead of limits. From this, you might get the impression that open sets are pretty important, and you would be absolutely correct. In general topology, all concepts derive from the concept of open sets, and connectedness is no exception. Actually, connectedness is a funny concept, because a space is defined to be connected if it is not disconnected. Now, a space is disconnected if we can find open sets U and V that separate X into two pieces. This means that U and V both need to cover part of X, and together must cover the entirety of X. To separate X, we have to make sure that no part of X is covered by both U and V. The intuition is that the wiggle room of each open set U and V forces a gap between the points in X. For example, suppose X is a subset of R that contains a positive number and a negative number, but does not contain zero. Then X is disconnected. Indeed, we can take the open sets U from minus infinity to zero, and V from 0 to infinity. Using our friend modus tollendo tollens, this example tells us that if X is a connected subset of R that contains both a positive and a negative number, then X must also contain 0. This is the heart of the intermediate value theorem, and states that the image of a connected set under a continuous function must also be connected. Leaning on modus tollendo tollens again, this is the same as saying that if f of x is disconnected, then x is disconnected. Luckily for us, with our fancy definition of continuity, this turns out to be a very simple exercise in topology. If u and v disconnect f of x, then the preimage of u and the preimage of v are open sets that disconnect x. Proofs like these are why QED stands for quite easily done. This may come as a surprise, but the connectivity of the closed interval AB is the most involved step of the entire proof of the intermediate value theorem. But don't worry, it's not that bad. Let's suppose U and V are open sets that cover the interval AB. Without loss of generality, let's assume that U contains the point A, but does not contain the entire interval. Then, we can take S to denote the supremum of the first contiguous component of U. Since U does not completely cover the interval, the supremum S is not in U. Since S is still in the interval AB, this means that S must fall in V. Now, since V is open, there is some wiggle room around S. In particular, a small epsilon width that comes right before S is simultaneously in V and in the first contiguous component of U. Therefore, U and V have a non-empty overlap in AB, meaning that U and V do not disconnect AB. This shows that AB is connected. Wow, G! That was way more complicated than the first proof. Since you put us through the entire argument, this must mean that the abstract proof hides an even more efficient equation-solving algorithm than the bisection method, right? I showed this to you because the proof is art, and art doesn't need to justify itself with utility. What about the algorithm you promised? Hey, don't put words in my mouth. I never promised a second algorithm. Now before you get mad at me for hoodwinking you, I also lied about what the second argument even proves in the first place. Let's go back to the context of having a continuous function f from a, b to r, such that f of a is negative and f of b is positive. Rather than proving that there must exist a point xi where f of xi is zero, I actually just proved that it's impossible for there not to be such a point. If you're thinking, what's the difference? Isn't that the same thing? I want you to know that you just assumed the law of the excluded middle.
Hell no, to the no, 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 hell to the no.
In the day-to-day life of a mathematician, excluding the middle is fine. If something is not false, then it must be true. However, once algorithms come into the question, then the middle cannot be excluded. False means false, but true can mean true and here's an algorithm, or true but I give no algorithm. If something is not false in this case, sure it means that it's true, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it comes with an algorithm. I mean really, all we can say in this case is that it's not false. So, can mathematicians code? Well, all I can tell you is that the statement mathematicians can code is not false. If you're still here, thank you for watching. If you didn't dislike what you just witnessed and you exclude the middle, then you must have liked what you just witnessed. If it's not that you didn't dislike the video, then exclude the middle or not, you didn't like the video. And that's cool. I'm always going to have that one fan at my back.